So in this one, I'm going to show you how to do intercooler charge piping. Wait, no. To do that, I have to hang an intercooler. Wait, no. To do that, I have to swap out the radiator. So yeah, that's what I'm going to show you how to do in this one. Is swap out your stock Ford radiator for an aluminum aftermarket one. This is the stock Ford radiator. It's big, it's old, it's crusty. It was leaking a little bit, although the truck never overheated or anything. However, its big flaw is that it doesn't allow any pass-through for the intercooler charge pipes, and that will be a problem. So the only other way to get around it is under it or through the core support, and I don't really want to do that. First step, drain the coolant, and then take out the four bolts holding the radiator to the core support itself. Pop off the two hoses and you're home free. It's really a very simple job to remove. However, as empty as you think it is, it's less empty than that. So don't wear your good pants when you're dealing with the cooling system. One last view of the old radiator and the mount holes that hold it to the core support. It's kind of neat how you can just drop the radiator in on the bottom two bolts and it'll support them. But here, you see the first radiator I got from eBay. I say the first because, well, if you look at it, something seems off about it. Hard to tell, though. Eh, a little bit of measuring. A little bit of thinking. Oh, have some coffee, think about... Oh, yeah. No, this is where you realize you're really screwed. This thing is just too big. It's too tall. It's too thin. It's too lots of stuff. It will not work. How won't it work? Well, it would come down to about where my thumb is here on the tape. And that is no good. I'm not going to put a big KO button on the front of the truck. So, fall on your sword, get a new radiator. And this one is supposed to be for a small block Chevy. Now, I don't know how small a block they had in mind, but it must have been pretty tiny, because this one has 1¼ inch inlets and a pinched off 1½ inch outlet. Also, both of those are on the same side, which won't work for a couple of reasons. First, because the stock hose locations for the truck are on opposite sides, and second, because if you don't have a cross flow on your radiator, it will promote having a big cold spot where the coolant doesn't flow and half your radiator doesn't work. So we're gonna have to go ahead and change this up a bit, and you'll see how we go ahead and do that here in just a second. So I'm going to go ahead and mark it out here for a stock location for a couple of reasons. One, while I'm probably going to use a hard pipe that I make myself at a certain point, having the availability of going to a parts store and just getting the right thing should you need to is really neat. The other part is that if I just sort of replace it where they are, it's going to smash the hoses straight into the fan, and that is obviously not going to work. And as we go putting all these chips and shavings into the radiator, you need a way to get them back out again. In my case, I used a shop vac for the holes that the regular nozzle fits in, and then for this little slot, I used a bit of heater hose and some duct tape. It works surprisingly well. On to the other side. It turns out I may have knocked most of the teeth off of this one when I was cutting something else. Forgot about that. Oh well, I guess I'll just put that on the list for when I go to the hardware store and spend an obscene amount on metric fasteners. This is an effective, if not particularly pretty, way of putting a bead roll on the end of a chunk of tube. A rounded off bolt head and a hammer, it does the job. Because the point of a bead roll is just to keep your hose and clamp from slipping off the end of a pressurized tube. That's it. It doesn't actually have to be that pretty, and I don't think anyone's going to be inspecting this part of the work. So, there's that. Now, make another fresh batch of artisanal hand-rubbed anti-seize, and we are off to the races.
To the sound of the monstrous clock, air is cleansed, assemble flock. Black candles burn, all minds align.
Said I didn't want to cut into the stock radiator core support, and that is true, but in this case, sacrifices will be made. It's just a single layer of sheet metal, so it's not that big of an issue, but I'm sure there is a way you could do this without adjusting the core support. I just am too lazy to figure it out.
Together.
got this set of dimple dies from TMR Customs a few years back, and really don't have that much call to use them, so I'm going to trot them out on this one. It provides kind of a neat little look there, and adds a little bit of rigidity to the parts, although I will still have to flange the tops to get them to be as rigid as they need to be. So, you're supposed to use these with a press, or you can use a nut and a bolt to draw them down, or in my case, you can counterbalance the bouginess of very expensive custom tools with a Harbor Freight dead blow. That's what I did. Well, the old step bit's getting a workout today. Over-drilled these off-square brackets that'll hold my intercooler in parallel with the radiator. And then I drilled some holes in the core support, added the riv nuts here and here, here and here, and gonna put a strut across here, but I haven't done it yet. And the duct tape here is to represent where the lower mounts for the radiator will be once I make them. Which will be soon, probably. So we tighten up everything and get it all installed, and that's it. Job done. That's how you take an easy afternoon project and stretch it out into a week. Because it turns out that's what happens to every so-called easy afternoon project around here. Come together! Come together.